All right, Ginoong Posadas, can you please give us an overview? Let's start with the numbers first. What is the latest death toll? May mga balita po, may mga bagong reports ng pagkamatay sa Parañaque, Cebu City at maging sa Northern Samar.
Tama po, Mama, no? Dito sa latest na datos natin, in our latest data na nilabas ngayon. But again, Ma'am Karen, these are still for validation. We have already noted 12, no? These are in Calabar Zone, Region 6, Region 7, and Region 8. But we are expecting this to change, Karen, because we are still monitoring some reports from the Bicol region and in some areas pa.
Okay, so itong 12 na po, ito ang total for now sa buong Pilipinas na?
Yes, ma'am. That's correct. For now, yan po ang total natin na reported death. But again, that's still for validation and confirmation.
At ano po karaniwan ang naging sanhi ng pagkamatay, sir?
Karamihan dito, ma'am, yung sa pagkalunod, meron din po yung trauma na pagsakan ng pader sa ulo. Tapos pero karamihan po sa kanila drowning incident, ma'am.
Oo, napakalungkot, no, na kumbaga may 12 na naitalang namatay. What is the comparison in terms of the preparation considering nagkaroon lang tayo ng nakaraang bagyo?
Walang masyadong let up, Karen, kasi mataas pa rin yung level ng preparations natin, ano. Ang nakita ko lang, notably, yung sinabi ng PAGASA with Enteng. Of course, pareho silang may enhancement ng habagat, ano. But si Enteng kasi was nearer the shoreline, mas malapit siya sa landmass. And therefore, mas nag-dump siya ng mas maraming tubig sa kalupaan natin. Starting with Cebu when they experienced yung pagbaha sa Northern Cebu. And then, of course, Region 8, Northern Samar, you mentioned that. And then the Bicol region, Calabar Zone, Metro Manila. And of course, sa Central Luzon. And ngayon, nandiyan siya sa Ilocos region kung masusunod yung matutuloy yung report ng PAGASA, Enteng will still intensify into a severe tropical storm or even a typhoon before he exits the Philippine area of responsibility.
Okay, but like in Antipolo, for example, we just reported on a victims. There was a 4-year-old that was killed because of the landslide. Nung nakaraang bagyo, ay kumbaga, those same people survived it. Is there a difference in terms of how local government units handled this particular storm? Were there local government units that should have done preemptive evacuation earlier on? Hindi ba nila naisip na malakas posible ang epekto ng Enteng? Did they miscalculate it?
I cannot really speak for them, Karen, but I think in terms of information dissemination, I was speaking for the last 3-4 days already to the media and of course our regional offices were almost in touch. They are always in touch with the local government units because that is the instruction of the President and, of course, of the Secretary of National Defense as the chair of the NGMC to always coordinate, to always liaise with the local government units because we rely heavily on them because they are our frontliners. And I think ito lang mga bagay na ito are, I would like to believe na hindi naman ito sinasadya. Especially itong mga local government units na ito in Rizal are very much used to this kinds of events. And so, papalagay ko naman na they have prepared for this and unfortunately nangyari lang ito, Karen.
All right. Among the provinces in the Philippines, which one was most hit, severely damaged by Enteng?
Hindi pa natin nakikuha yung reports, Karen, but I can name a few. Ano, at least sa Region 7, doon una dumaan. Ano, and then, of course, Northern Samar, you reported that earlier. And then dito sa Bicol region din, Metro Manila din, no? And then Calabar Zone. And we are still waiting for the reports dito sa dinadaanan niya pa ngayon dito sa Central Luzon at sa Kapataas, Karen. But I think those are the most affected regions with Enteng, pending the official reports, Karen.
Okay. So do you have an initial assessment of the damage already? And perhaps coming from the last storm, that was just a few weeks ago. So we haven't even recovered from that yet.
Yeah, Karen, because we're entering yung La Nina period and ito are actually litmus test. In terms of preparations, I think everybody prepared, but the other question is when do we say we have prepared enough? But I think no let up ito, no? Especially ngayon, Karen, just to report to you that for 2 days now, your NDRMC in Camp Aguinaldo is on red alert. It's the highest alert that we put up in times like this, so that we could focus more on what are needed. And so, yun yung ginagawa natin ngayon, Karen, and especially also with that is complemented by the elevation of the alert status of the concerned regions also to red.
Okay. And when it's on red alert, what kind of action can we expect on the ground?
This is this means that everybody, all hands, ito Karen, no, the decision makers, the tactical operators, all the resources, all the equipment needed, all the think tanks are there, no, physically or virtually, and at an instance or at the short notice, we can provide assistance, no, because how we do it is actually. Doon muna sa level ng mga frontliners natin who are the LGUs, Karen. And then if resources are needed further, then we tap our regional resources. And then kung kulang pa, we have our national resources at the NDRM OC. And when we are on red alert, at least mas mabilis yung ma-facilitate lahat ito, even yung mga pagpapadala ng augmentation. If aircrafts are needed, then we can provide. If trucks are needed, then we could provide. If rescue teams, retrieval teams are needed, then we could provide. If we need food and non-food items, augmentation, and even QRF, yung quick response fund, then we can facilitate easily, Karen.
Oo. And ang rehiyon na mas kumbaga sinalanta ng Enteng is really Luzon. Is that correct? Visayas and Mindanao this time were spared.
Yes, yeah, I think based on initial reports, Karen. Yes, but in terms of families affected, I have here initial figures. No, ang total kasi ngayon, Karen, is for all the regions affected, 62,959 families or 240,000 persons. At ang pinakamarami dito sa datos natin, Karen, ay sa Region 5. 22,220 families, followed by Region 3, 18,092, and NCR, 9,000, almost 10,000 families. But again, these figures will change because as we now receive your assessment reports, tinatali natin dito, and we will see a clearer picture maybe in the next few days, Karen.
Yeah. Wow. So you already have more than 62,000 families affected. And considering we've just experienced Enteng roughly, it's just been a day or so, right?
That's correct, Karen. And kaya nga, there's a lot to be learned from this. So, kagaya nito, ang peculiarity nito, I think, is Enteng was nearer the landmass as compared to Carina. But of course, pareho silang nag-enhance ng habagat. But we will know, Karen, as we do the post-mortem activity on assessing what went right and what needs to be improved. We always do that after every disaster. So in time, maybe we can. It is our goal to really improve our processes and systems so that we could have less and less of this very expensive response mechanism, Karen.
Okay, that's very good. It's how to have less and less of this very expensive response mechanism. Tama yan eh. Ang tanong ko lang, no, because Enteng was closer to the landmass, so it actually dumped like 2 months of the amount of rainfall in one of the areas. Would you say at this point that we've experienced flooding Because the last storm, we've also experienced severe flooding, right? And the president was quite concerned with that. He visited the pumping stations, and the president actually wanted a review of the flood plan. Diba? Ang tanong, mas matindi pa ba ang pagbanga dito kaysa nung nakaraan?
Sa ngayon, Karen, I cannot readily say, you know, but tama ka, I was about to say those things, so especially with the president being hands-on, really. He wants a master plan enhanced, or the previous one reviewed. It should be more comprehensive. It should be more technology and engineering based, no? Because kailangan, sabi niya, gamitin natin yung available technology, available engineering solutions, no, to the problem, and then yung mga strategies natin, hindi lang uphill but the downhill side, magkasabay sila, and all this, no. Plus Karen, isang importante dun sa sinabi mo, I'd like to support that, no, reiterate yung kasi maraming social component din ito, eh, yung like yung basura, yung pagdami ng tao, yung deforestation. So of course hindi natin i-excuse, talagang maraming there's really a lot of rains that was that was dumped, no? But again, marami pang other factors na pwede natin gawan ng paraan para nga mas mamitigate natin yung effects. And then, if I may, Karen, no, kasi dun sa batas, yung RA 10121, may apat na thematic pillars. Ang very popular dyan yung response, eh, kasi nandyan yung ayuda, nandyan yung mga tulong, but we would like to refocus, no? Even the president would like to refocus on the other first two thematic pillars, yung tinatawag natin na prevention and mitigation. This is under the vice chairmanship of the DOST. And I think they're doing a good job, especially on forecasting, especially on yung kanilang information dissemination. Medyo mataas na ngayon yung accuracy, and of course yung preparedness under the DILG, yung capacity building, and we continue to capacitate our local government units because they are our vital link talaga to our public, and sila yung frontliners, and so if they do good, then there's less and less of us sa national, and we can focus more on the other things, but particularly on policies and revisiting of procedures para mas maganda, and then we implement it together as one nation, the whole of nation approach, which is basically the context of the NDRIMC right now, Karen.
Now, I mean, this is a bit, it's a bit micro for your office, but I'm curious, it was never answered. Do you remember when the president toured the pumping stations and some local government officials, and they actually saw that the pumping stations weren't running, some of them weren't running, and some of them were filled with trash? Which agency is frankly in charge of making sure all the pumping stations where the people's money was spent, that they should be running efficiently? Who's supposed to manage these pumping stations?
Basically, Karen, kasi ito yung dito sa Metro Manila, it's a partnership between, of course, the MMDA, DPWH, and then, of course, yung mga local government units, no? And tulong-tulong ito. Ako, I'd like to answer your question in a very strategic manner, no? That with the council there, the local council there, with everybody sitting there, I think that's the best forum para pag-usapan natin ito, basing it from the from the president's guidance, really, to come up with this more relevant, more effective and efficient plans, no? It starts from there, and kasi pag naplano natin mabuti to, there's less and less, really, there's of spoilage of funds, and na-address natin yung cyclical events na yon of building, rebuilding, and then building again. So pagka if we build it more better, no, meaning with the engineering interventions available right now, and of course Karen, yung kasi itong goal natin ito is we need the participation of our public, ating safety and resilience is inclusive, no? It is a partnership between the person and the government.
Yeah, but then what's interesting is, I think in the last 5 years, you've seen the numbers, sir. We've set aside, I think, if my figures serve me correctly, my memory is more than 400 billion pesos when it comes to flood control, right? So the thing is, Why aren't we seeing it is the question. Where did it go wrong? Where was it spent? I mean, in the office of the OCD, do you have at least an initial study? Where did our flood control projects go?
Karen, with your indulgence, I'm not very much privy to that. I may be taken out of context, but at least what I'm saying is, yes, we have spent a lot for this flood control measures to include infrastructure. And I think with the president's guidance, it's high time for us to improve, do it right this time by with a sound and comprehensive planning with everybody there, and then with the plans come the individual activities such as building of the flood control infrastructure, and then we put our money there, and we make sure that there is accountability, there is a focal agency or persons, and we just have to implement it well, because it's high time now. We have to do it right because of the, you know, the changing times that require things to be put in place, Karen.
All right. On that note, I want to thank you so much for joining me today, Mr. Edgar Posadas of the Office of Civil Defense. Thank you, sir.
Thank you for having us, Karen. Thank you, and good day.